Good morning, one and all, and welcome to our online church service this Sunday. I understand that we are having a few technical challenges getting this published on YouTube. So not sure what's going to happen there, but please do stay with us here on Zoom. As you might have heard in the preview video that just played, we recommend that during the time of worship, that you engage with it fully. This is a time, this is a precursor to what we'll be doing when Jesus returns, which is to worship God with our whole hearts and our entire bodies. And if you are able to stand, you will probably find it easier to do that, standing up or dancing or whatever. And also, good idea to turn the volume up, because although we're apart, because we're apart, it sometimes feels like a bit weird because we're doing this on our own, and having the music louder kind of helps. During the time of worship, we will, as usual, make opportunities to share. So if you've got something to share, please put a note in the chat window. If you click the chat button, you'll see that. Put a note, and I will pick that up later in the time of worship and give you an opportunity. So that could be a prayer, a word that's on your heart from the Lord, or a reading from God's word. At the end of the service, stick around for our breakout rooms time. That is when we gather into slightly smaller groups and we just have a chat via Zoom. You are very, very welcome to stay for that. One particular notice, there is a prayer meeting. That's tonight at 7 o'clock. And the information on how to join that prayer meeting is in the weekly news bulletin. There's one from the 5th of July, 5th of June even, getting a month ahead of myself, 5th of June, and we'll try and get a further notice out today, but the information about how to join remains the same. The meetings are recorded. Just want to make sure that you're aware of this. This is, amongst other reasons, to ensure that we can upload it to YouTube once we get that working. If you feel particularly uncomfortable being recorded in any way, feel free to switch your video off, but we make every effort to ensure that individuals' videos don't show when we publish to YouTube. That's about all that I've got to say. Keith will be sharing the word with us, and now I'm going to hand over to Rosannah, who's going to lead us in worship.
Thank you, Rob. So this morning, I just wanted to start with a few verses from Exodus 15. I will sing to the Lord, for he is highly exalted. Both horse and driver he has hurled into the sea. The Lord is my strength and my defense. He has become my salvation. He is my God, and I will praise him. My father's God, and I will exalt him. The Lord is a warrior. The Lord is his name. Your right hand, Lord, has majestic power. Your right hand, Lord, shattered the enemy. Who among the gods is like you, Lord? Who is like you, majestic and in holiness, awesome in glory, working wonders? Stretch out your right hand, and the earth swallows your enemies. In your unfailing love, you will lead the people you have redeemed. In your strength, you will guide them in your holy dwelling. The Lord reigns forever and ever. So let's just come together this morning and worship God. We're going to start with a praise the name.
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound shall return in robes of white. The blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints. My case transfixed on Jesus' face.
Oh, praise the name.
Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh, Lord our God. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory.
Worthy is the King.
So after this next song that we're going to play, we're going to have a time that you can share. And so I just want to really encourage you to share testimonies that you've had this week or anything that God's been talking to you about. So we're going to sing King of Kings, Majesty first, though.
You and we bless you, we glorify you, we do live to serve you, Lord, and let that be our cry. Paul, you've got something to share, please go ahead.
I have. Hello, everybody. So just a testimony really of a couple of things, I suppose. Some of you will know that Bex have been testing positive for COVID for quite a while with no symptoms, anything like that. And we've been off work, and so that's meant I've not had shifts and stuff. So first, two things to thank God for, really, that we want to just share with you to encourage. First of all, Bex is testing negative, so that's good. So she's back in work. Heidi's back in nursery. I've still not got work. That's something to pay for, but I can go back. But also that God provided for us, some people in church, and if you're involved in this, thank you really a lot for this, that put some money together and helped to provide for us so that we've got a little bit next month, so thank you for that. And also just that God provided. And we've seen him provide so many times, and every time this sort of thing happens, I worry again. But it's been like, you know, he provides. And if you're asking, God provides as well. So I just want to encourage you with that and show you what God's been doing. He's really good, isn't he? He's really good. So yeah, God's good. That's amazing. Thank you.
Oh, amen. Thank you, Paul. Martin and Debbie, over to you.
Hi, yes, I just wanted to share something that I sort of started last Tuesday in our house group when I talked about last week. I felt like I was being three of God molds us like clay. Well, I felt like I very much had been thrown down several times, like they throw down clay. And I said to Martin that I thought they threw it down because it got the air out of it. And Martin said, do you think that's right? Which was very clever of him, because then I looked it up and apparently the pot is, you might know this, I don't know, but the pot is thrown down so that the vase grows taller. So when it grows up taller. So I just wanted to encourage people that if you feel like you're being thrown down and things are hard at the minute, it's because God wants to raise you up taller. Yeah. Okay, that's it.
Amen. Yeah, and we know as Christians that in times of trouble and testing, God refines us. On the theme of encouragement, I wanted to read something from Revelation. I've been in Revelation for a little while now, and it's just phenomenal to see what our future is. And while I'm reading this, there's still time. If you want to share something, just put a note in the chat and I'll bring you in after this. But this is from Revelation 21. And this is the vision that John had from God. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. Isn't it glorious? We bless you, God. We bless you for the hope that we have. Thank you, Father. Sarah. Should be unmuted any second. There you go. Go ahead.
Oh, got it. Thank you. I would like to share this. And as I do, I'm just rejoicing at when the Holy Spirit's at work and things that we're hearing are all touching on the same theme. So we're pretty sure that the Holy Spirit has a hand and is moving on this. And I would like to share Psalm 126. I'm reading from New King James because my Amplified is upstairs. But when the Lord brought back the captivity of Zion, we were like those who dream. Then our mouth was filled with laughter and our tongue with singing. Then they sang amongst the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us, and we are glad. Bring back our captivity, O Lord, as the streams in the south. Those who sow in tears shall reap in joy. He who continually goes forth weeping, bearing seeds for sowing, shall doubtless come again with rejoicing, bringing his sheaves with him. Lord, we thank you for these encouraging words. And you are bringing us back, as you brought the captives in Babylon back to Jerusalem. And you are filling our lives with goodness and harvest times and seeds for sowing. And the time of rejoicing is coming. And let us rejoice in the good and in the bad times, as well as the good times, Lord, because those who sow in tears shall reap in joy, and good things are coming. And we just praise you and thank you, Lord. And we thank you for your word this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Back to you, Rosannah.
So I'm just going to play the chorus of This Is Our God, if you'd like to sing along.
I will fall at your feet.
that again. glory. We'll give Him all the glory. We'll give Him all the glory. We'll give you all the glory. Christ the Lord. Oh, come, let us adore Him. Oh, come, let us adore Him. Oh, come, let us adore Him, Christ the Lord. Yes, Lord Jesus, we give you all the glory, Lord Jesus. It all belongs to you. I thank you for everything that you've done. I think Lisa's got something to share.
Go ahead, Lisa.
Hi, everyone. Morning. What I'm going to share is not from me sort of saying I've got this all together at all. It's probably to me more than anyone. But God's taken me to Romans 12, a living sacrifice to God. I'm just going to read it. And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all He has done for you. Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind He will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship Him. Don't copy the behaviour and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know that God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. And I was just listening to a sermon this week by Tim Keller, and I was just wanting to share really what I took away from it to help others. But remember that Jesus' sacrifice was sufficient. But every day we should offer ourselves to God. What do we kill every day? What do we put to death? Our desire to live for ourselves. Do we put to death our desire to know that God knows best for us, to trust in Him? We need to take our hands off the driving wheels of our life. And we must realise that God is infinitely wise, good and loving, and He knows what is best for us. And are we picking and choosing who is on the throne? Sometimes we putting ourselves on the throne, and then sometimes we're putting God on the throne. And I just wanted to share it because it really convicted me, and I feel that it's something to do on a daily basis that we need to do to encourage everyone.
Thank you. Thank you, Lisa. Rosannah, have we another song?
Yes, but Robert's just put a note in the chat.
Ah, Robert. Excellent. Let me find it. Here we go, Robert. One sec. There you go.
I'm unmuted, yeah?
You're unmuted. Go ahead.
Well, I had a dream this morning, or before I woke up. It was about, because I was on a bus and I lost my phone. I was like, where's my phone? But I felt God to say to me, yeah, losing my phone, it's worthless. And I've got a scripture backing it up about worthless, and it says Philippians 3:8, yet everything else is worthless when compared with the infinite value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For His sake I have decided everything else, counting it all as garbage, so that I could gain Christ.
Amen. And that is phenomenal. What a scripture. Very challenging. Go ahead, Rosanna.
The Word at the beginning, one with God the Lord Most High, hidden in glory in creation.
wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is, nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater.
I've just got one more song, and we've done it once, I think, in church before, so most people probably won't remember it. But I've just had this going round and round in my head all week, so I felt like I've needed to do it. I don't really know why, but yeah.
Lavishes grace as our burdens grow greater. He sends us more strength as our labors increase. To added afflictions, he offers more mercy. To multiply trials, he multiplies peace. When we have endurance when our strength has failed and the days have done. When we've reached the end of our earthly resources, Father's forgiving is only begun.
We thank you, Father God, that you are perfectly trustworthy, perfectly faithful, perfectly loving. And thank you that we can lean on you, that there's nothing better that we can do. Father, you are our source and our salvation, and we give all due worship to you. Amen. Keith, We are looking forward to hearing what God has for us. So when you're ready, please do share.
Good morning, everybody. It's great to see you again this morning. Welcome to Freedom Church. This morning, if you want to turn in your Bibles to Acts chapter 19, and we're looking at verses 11 through to 20. I wonder what you'd do. I want you to imagine the scene. You're walking down the street and you see these seven men running out of a house. Their clothes are torn so badly that they're virtually naked. They're bleeding. They look as if, one of them looks as if they've got a dislocated shoulder. The other one is limping so badly he's almost hopping. And the look on their face is sheer terror. Do you call for help? Do you investigate? Who do you tell? And there's one thing that's for sure, this is unsettling, it's disturbing, it's not normal. It feels evil. Paul has been in Ephesus for 3 months and he's been speaking about Jesus in the synagogue to virtually anyone who's going to listen to him. But he's eventually forced out of there, and so he moves his ministry to a schoolroom and he preaches there for a further 2 years. And the result of that, well, verse 10 succinctly sums it up. It says, people throughout the province of Asia, both Jew and Greek, heard the word of the Lord. And this was a time of just great blessing. His ministry was extremely fruitful, so much so that even Paul's enemies had to admit that God's word was spreading and that the people were being saved. So today, as we pick up the story in Acts 19, verse 11, we read, God gave Paul the power to perform unusual miracles with handkerchiefs or aprons that had merely touched his skin. They were placed on sick people and they were healed of their diseases and evil spirits were expelled. And in this passage, we're confronted with the supernatural. We read about these incredible miracles that God enabled Paul to perform that were so dramatic that often all it would take was for a cloth that Paul had touched to come into contact with a sick or a demon-possessed person, and they would be healed. But actually, Paul was simply following the example of the Lord Jesus Christ. When Paul healed the sick and cast out demons, he is showing loving compassion on the people that he's ministering to. At the same time, the miracle he's performing is just intrinsically linked with the message of the word of God. Healing lies at the very heart of the gospel. And in everything that he does, he's pointing people to Jesus, the one who is Lord over all, the one who deserves all the glory. You see, Paul wants people to know that he's not performing these miracles. He's simply an ambassador for Jesus Christ. So everything that he does comes from the foundation that we spoke about last week of being filled with the Holy Spirit. And if you missed that, do go back and have a listen. You'll be able to catch it online. And we find that throughout the Bible, we read stories about healings. It begins right actually at the very beginning of the Bible in the Old Testament, in the book of Exodus. God reveals himself as, I am the Lord who heals you. In Numbers 21 and verse 9, Moses erected a bronze serpent in the wilderness and the people who looked at it were healed. Also, in the Old Testament, we read about men like Elijah and Elisha who saw just incredible healings as a direct response to their prayers. Then into the New Testament, when Jesus begins his ministry and declares that the promised kingdom of God is at hand, he introduces himself in Luke chapter 4 by quoting from Isaiah 61. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me because he's anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He sent me to proclaim freedom to the prisoner and recovery of sight to the blind, to set the oppressed free. It has been said, and really without much exaggeration, that every time we meet Jesus in the gospel, he's either healing someone, or he's returning from a healing, or he's just about to go and heal someone else. He never turned anybody away. In fact, in some cases, it's recorded that he healed everyone who was present. In fact, very often, Jesus even initiated healings rather than waiting to be asked. And Peter sums up Jesus' ministry in Acts chapter 10, verse 38. God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power. He went around doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil because God was with him. And what we see from Jesus' attitude to sickness is actually just a revelation of the will and the purpose of God, our Heavenly Father. See, Jesus only did the Father's work and will. And in case anybody is in any doubt at all, he declared that the Father and I are one. And throughout the Gospels, we see how God is inarguably and totally for healing. He is against sickness, and therefore, it would be crazy to think that that has changed. How could an unchanging, loving God who is in control of everything have somehow changed his attitude towards healing today? So, as we explore the subject of healing and deliverance, and the Bible doesn't seem to separate these, we start with a right understanding of the power of God revealed to us perfectly in Jesus Christ. That comes to those who believe through the anointing of the Holy Spirit, and our joy and our hope comes as a direct result of knowing God and being in his presence. And our essential prayer must be that the kingdom of God comes now on earth as it is in heaven. This is God's desire over your life and over our church. So as Spirit-filled Christians, we join the great battle that is fought not with swords, but with the gospel of Jesus Christ, who is crucified and is risen from the dead. And Paul says those well-known verses in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, for our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against rulers, against authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in heavenly realms. See, it's fought for the souls of men and women. It's fought in the power of the Holy Spirit. It's fought with words of truth and deeds of love and justice. It's a cry to bring the full gospel, repentance and faith in Jesus that will see people restored, forgiven, set free and healed. God is a supernatural God. So it should not surprise any of us when he does supernatural things, miracles, healings, signs, wonders. See, God has not changed. And when God's Spirit touches a person's life, he brings healing and he brings deliverance. And that still happens today. I want you to have a listen to a couple of testimonies. These were taken from New Day a year or two back, where Adrian Hollowell is doing the interviews. Have a listen.
Tell us your name.
I'm Rebecca.
And where are you from?
St Ives, Cambridgeshire.
Great. And just tell us, what's your role in your church here at New Day?
I'm a youth leader.
Okay, fantastic. So she's one of the youth leaders here, one of many here. What was the problem that you had when you came to New Day last year, Rebecca?
I had a problem with my back. I had a bulging disc, and I also had a bad knee from an injury. I had a tendon problem.
Okay, and you were telling me that you'd had back trouble since you were 19, is that right?
Yep.
So tell us what happened last year.
Let's see. So you asked us to pray. I put my hand on my knee and on my back, and I had a a warm feeling and a flowing feeling going through my knee. I didn't feel anything in my back. And so I went outside to test it and ran up and down a field, which I hadn't done for a long time.
Fantastic. So you were completely healed?
Yes, both my knee and my back.
And tell us, isn't that great? Tell us, what difference practically has being healed of these problems since you were 19, yeah? What difference has it made to be kind of normal?
It's amazing. I've got two little boys who I'm able to pick up and play with, and they're not having to worry that they're gonna hurt me when cuddling me and things like that. So yeah, I'm able to run again. So lots of things.
You were telling me, Heather, that you'd had a very long-standing problem with your hearing, is that right?
That's correct, yeah.
So tell us, how long had you had a hearing loss?
Since I was a child, so about 10 years ago. Now and again. A long, long time.
So you were saying that it was only 20% hearing and 80% hearing loss?
That's correct, yeah.
And you were here last year at New Day. Tell us what happened.
I was being prayed for, and there was people on this side and lots of noise around, and I realised I could hear out of this ear. So, yeah.
So you'd had this hearing loss for your whole life since a child, and all of a sudden you can hear normally?
Yep, that's correct, yeah.
Wow.
Fantastic. But I know that that's only part of the healing story, that you've also had another healing in your family. Do you want to tell us about that?
Yeah, my son Lucas was diagnosed with ADHD about 5 years ago. Had to take medication, the highest dose of a drug called Concerta. He got prayed for it in New Day, and he hasn't had a tablet since. So.
Wow. And he's been taking these tablets for 4 years?
5 years.
5 years of daily ADHD combating drugs, and then he didn't take his tablet, and he's been signed off. He doesn't need the tablets?
He hasn't touched a tablet since, and he's a totally changed person.
That's fantastic.
And we just praise God. These are just wonderful stories. These are just miraculous, life-changing healings. I'll tell you just one more story. One of my aunts is a counsellor, and she had counselled a young woman who, from about the age of 12 years old, had an eating disorder. And 10 years has gone past, and she's seen something like 17 different counsellors and specialists before she comes to my aunt. The previous specialist had pretty much signed her off. It told her that you have no hope. We just can't do anything for you. And her family were at their wits' end, and they actually felt that this could not cope with her anymore, so they asked her to leave their home. However, that year, they had booked themselves into a Christian conference with some friends. And when one of their friends dropped out at the last minute, they were praying about who they would invite along, and they'd barely finished praying when the phone rings, and it's the sister on the phone. And the sister says to them, God has told me that I need to be at that conference this year because God is going to heal me. Truth was, this was the last person that they actually expected to phone them. And after a few hours, they phoned her back and invited her to stay with them. And during that week, she went forward for prayer in one of the meetings. And as the Holy Spirit touched her, God healed her instantly from her eating disorder. And she walked out of that meeting and she said to her sister, let me take you out for dinner. Bear in mind, she hasn't eaten a proper meal for something like 8 to 10 years. And this girl has now began to put weight on. She says to my aunt, says, I never knew that food could taste so good. You see, God can do in seconds what years of counseling just cannot do. And when the Spirit of God turns up, victory comes. But of course, the story raises a number of important questions that we certainly need to consider, because I cannot begin to understand why God would allow someone to struggle through years of hell before healing her, or why he intervenes in some people's lives and yet not in others. But I do know that unless God turns up in a miraculous way, we cannot have true victory. Because unless the Holy Spirit moves, we can go through the motions of church, but lives are not changed, people are not healed, and we will not have the victory, at least not on this side of eternity, because there is no formula. We can pray over handkerchiefs all we want, but unless the Holy Spirit's anointing is present, nothing happens. So don't look for formulas. God will not be boxed in. But we need to turn to Him, to cry out to Him. And healing is not some sort of magic act that has God at our beck and call. See, God's not at the end of a rope that we just tug on when we want something done. That's just not how it works. The reality is, in my experience, is that not everyone is healed. And it's one of the mysteries of the kingdom of God, the now and the not yet, because some of the most faith-filled believers who I know journey with sickness and with pain. But yet it never stops us from asking. Keep praying, keep seeking for God's healing, God's touch. See, when you witness a miraculous healing, you get a glimpse of heaven. And this reminder that one day that Jesus will come back, He's going to return, and that we will have perfect bodies. There'll be no sickness, there's no death, there's no pain. When God's kingdom finally comes in all of its glory, Jesus will make all things new without exception. But in the meantime, we live in this dilemma of why some are healed and others are not. But it doesn't change the fact that Jesus wants to use you today to show other people God's kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. So we will pray for the sick, for people's problems. We will believe for healings. We'll expect God to do what only God can do. And when God answers, we tell them that Jesus did the work, that we give all glory, we give honor to God. Because God's involvement is the only thing that will ensure breakthrough, and we need breakthrough. It's only when the Holy Spirit comes and moves in our lives that He brings transformation. And the key to unlocking healing is prayer. Victory comes by prayer. And your prayers are God's way of accomplishing the victory of Jesus Christ over this world. And perhaps you've never thought about praying in this way before, but as your faith is soaked in prayer, and as you cry, as the cry of your heart is for God to intervene in your life, in your church, and in your nation, you're lifting up the banner of God over the community, and you're raising a shout of joy, a shout of victory. So you look forward to the triumph of God as you declare Jesus is King. But miraculous healings are only part of Paul's experience in Ephesus, because there's a battle going on over nations, over cities, over communities, and Ephesus was no different. I want to pick the story back up again. We're in chapter 19, verse 13 this time. It reads, "A group of Jews were traveling from town to town casting out evil spirits. They tried to use the name of the Lord Jesus in their incantations, saying, 'I command you in the name of Jesus, whom Paul preaches, to come out.' Seven sons of Sceva, a leading priest, were doing this. But one time when they tried it, the evil spirit replied, 'I know Jesus and I know Paul, but who are you?' Then the man with the evil spirit leaped on them, overpowered them, attacked them with such violence that they fled from the house naked and battered. The story of what happened spread quickly all through Ephesus to the Jews and to the Greeks alike. A solemn fear descended on the city, and the name of the Lord Jesus was greatly honored. Many who became believers confessed their sinful practices. A number of them who had been practicing sorcery brought their incantation books and burnt them at a public bonfire. The value of the books was several million dollars. So the message about the Lord spread widely and had a powerful impact. See, Ephesus was the center of the occult. And Paul is demonstrating God's power in the very heart of Satan's territory. However, the reality is that wherever God's people minister truth, Satan is going to come against them. And very often he sends a counterfeit to oppose his work. And one of Satan's most successful ploys is to imitate whatever God's people are doing, because he knows that many people will often not be able to tell the difference. The story that ends with beaten and naked men running for their lives begins with a well-known Jewish priest called Sceva, who had seven sons. And they go to a house to perform an exorcism on a man who's possessed by a demonic spirit. But it was not unusual for Jewish priests to try and cast out demons, but what was unusual was for them to use the name of Jesus. And since these men had no personal relationship with Jesus, they had to use the name of Paul as well. In fact, they are just deliberately copying, imitating Paul. And I guess this description does give us a clue. It gives an insight into how Paul dealt with demons. So just as Paul did, they speak directly to the demon and they command it in the name of Jesus to come out of its victim. What could go wrong? The demon speaks because it knows it has the upper hand. And it says, I know Jesus and I know Paul, but who are you? And the demon who has taken control of this man attacks the seven priests. He drives them from the house, and it's absolute carnage. Their clothes are ripped off. They are beaten. They're literally running for their lives. They are so frightened. And they learned a valuable lesson that day. If you underestimate Satan's power, if you try to fight the demonic in your own strength without Jesus Christ, you will not succeed. So while I believe that Satan has been defeated at the cross, Jesus Christ has got the victory. There's no question, there's no doubt about that. Satan is not powerless, not yet. Because once again we discover that fighting the demonic does not merely depend on the right formula or just carefully using carefully selected chosen words. Listen, there is no formula. You deal with demonic forces in the power and with the authority of Jesus Christ. And to do that, you must be a sincere follower of Jesus, who by faith is under the protection of the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ and who is listening to the voice of the Holy Spirit. And the problem is that we can react to stories like this by just simply becoming defensive. Even as Christians, we can run away in fear and we think, I don't want anything to do with that. And it can look something a little bit like this.
What is happening?
It's the curse. The curse is going to perish us. We're going to perish all over the place. Oh, this. There, follow me.
This way.
I'm bleeding out! I'm losing my force!
Oh, no! It's juice box. It's just juice box.
I think we're safe. For now.
Not safe! Not safe! Not safe!
But that's not how the Christian is called to live. You need to learn to take both a defensive and an offensive position. See, as good warriors do. That's why Paul writes again in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10 and 11, finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. So while we are called to stand firm, we are called to take a defensive stance, which you do by being committed to righteousness, to truth in all of your life. However, you also must take an offensive position as well. It's not just about holding ground. You and I need to be taking new ground. But unfortunately, too many people operate, too many Christians operate only in a defensive mode spiritually, and they're unwilling to take new ground, and they even end up feeling that Satan's got the upper hand. Church, listen to me. We need to go on the offensive. You know, it's all well and good to stand in church and to attend meetings after meeting and to hear that God is building his church, and of course he is. And we can even declare that the church is mighty and that the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And it's important we do declare that. But the sad truth is that in many areas, the gates of hell are prevailing. Entire cities, communities, schools, families, marriages, individuals are trapped behind the gates of hell. And the Bible does not say that the gates of hell are going to just automatically fold or fall down. Gates are for defensive purposes, but if there is no attack, they will continue to stand and they are not going to fall down by themselves. We have to move against them. The strong, mature body of Christ must go on the offensive and must advance against the gates of hell, and then they will not prevail. Matthew 16, verse 18. But I can't overemphasize this enough. You can't do this without God. And he will not do it apart from you. You must learn to be a warrior, to walk faithfully in obedience to God, and learn to rely on him completely. God is calling you to take responsibility. Yes, he will do it through you by the power of his Spirit, but you must stand up and take action. You need to evangelize. You must be praying. You are to resist the devil. If you do not resist the devil, he will not be resisted. And you will become an effective warrior when you're filled with the Holy Spirit in the name of Jesus, and then you are equipped with his infinite power and grace. But if you're waiting around for God to do it all, you're waiting in vain. That is not the way that God operates in this world. And much of what he does through his people. And he has told you exactly what to do. He's given you all the weapons that you need to do it. And the primary way in which you engage in spiritual warfare is through prayer. Paul writes to Timothy, 1 Timothy 2, verse 1. He says, I urge you then, first of all, that petitions, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgiving be made for all people. And as you intercede, you are a threat to Satan and the forces of evil. And as you stand between us, you stand in the gap, you hinder the work of Satan on the earth, and you turn away his attack and you destroy his plans. But what the devil tries to do, and often does it very effectively, is to preoccupy our minds and our energies with ourselves. And the more that he can distract us, the more that we can be fighting internally or focusing on our own problems, the less effective that you are going to be in intercessory prayer. Because Satan wants you to be bound up by fear, by depression, to be crippled by lust, by materialism, anything that will stop you from praying. In fact, He probably doesn't even mind if you're praying as long as you're praying self-centered prayers. And you need to wake up and you need to get up and you need to see the threat that you are to him as an intercessor and realize how significant you are as God's agent here on earth. You need to actively resist the powers of darkness and stand against his works and effects in people's lives. However, I suspect that most of us do not stand in the authority that is ours in Christ Jesus to resist the enemy and to come against him. Now, don't get me wrong. God is not limited to us. He can do what he wants when he wants. He is sovereign. He's not bound by anyone or anything. God is God. However, God has chosen to include you and me to take responsibility and take authority for this world. And God has chosen to move in the affairs of people to the degree to which you pray. God will not eliminate the middleman or woman. So there are certain areas that God will not move in unless you pray. And he is astonished that you don't pray. I believe Paul was a man of prayer. In fact, the interesting conclusion to the story pretty much proves that. It also just provides us this beautiful example of how the ministry of healing and deliverance can affect a whole community. The sight of these seven brothers fleeing in panic from demons had a profound impact on the whole of Ephesus. And a strong dividing line is drawn between the disciples of Jesus and the unbelievers. You see, had this exorcism succeeded, it had the potential to discredit the name of Jesus and the ministry of the church in Ephesus. But as we've seen many times before, God turns the evil plans of Satan around. And what appears to be a win for the demonic forces of Satan is quite the opposite. Instead of disgracing the name of Jesus, this event magnifies Jesus' name. So rather than damaging the church grows rapidly, and with it comes a new seriousness in regard to sin. So much so that those who have become followers of Jesus confess their sinful practices. And there is no place in the church for hidden sin. True believers cannot live with one foot in the kingdom of God and then another foot in the kingdom of Satan. An example of these Ephesian Christians is one that each of us must follow by examining our own hearts. For them, it required the removal of their possessions of magic books containing the secret formulas that they used in occultic practices. And these books were, of course, very valuable, and it was costly. Don't overlook how challenging this act of repentance was. But once their eyes are opened to the real spiritual issue, they openly confess their evil deeds. They brought their books and their spells together. They burnt them publicly. It must have been a huge bonfire. And the books that they burnt that day were estimated to be around a value of something like several million dollars. And as they repented, as they turned from their sins, they realized that Jesus was more valuable than any amount of personal wealth. True faith and repentance is costly. And we don't talk about this enough. See, faith and repentance require sacrifice that sometimes, in fact, nearly always will hurt. But there really is no place for sin in the life of a believer. We need to make clean breaks from sin and to break every tie with Satan. Anything that is not of God must be removed from your life and from your home. Jesus has called you and he's called me to live a holy life in obedience to him and to him alone. And repentance begins with an attitude of brokenness over sin. But true repentance will be followed by this earnest desire, this sincere effort to put away the sin that you've repented of. As you mourn over your sin against an infinitely holy God, you will find peace with God. And by God's grace, you will discover hope in the promise that God will not despise a broken and contrite heart. Psalm 51, verse 17. But repentance is not just about dealing with sin through the cleansing blood of Jesus Christ. It's putting on the Christ-like virtues that are missing in your life through the Holy Spirit. And I cannot speak for anybody else other than myself, but I often find myself failing as much as I succeed at times. And when I fail, it should bring me back to a broken and a contrite heart that just mourns over sin. Brokenness and repentance are marks of a growing Christian. And over time, it brings transformation. Gradually, but supernaturally, it moves us and changes us to become more and more like Jesus. And this is why we continually need the gospel. The wonderful news that Jesus Christ died to pay the penalty for your sins. Yes, all of them. He dealt with them all. The big sins, the little sins, the so-called respectable sins, those little white lies as we often talk about. They need dealt with. The sins that we are painfully conscious of and the sins that we are not even aware of. As the old hymn says, my sin, not in part but in whole, has been nailed to the cross and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, O my soul. Make repentance a regular part of your time in God's presence. Don't rush it. Allow the Holy Spirit to shine the light of God's word on your heart. And if you live with unrepented sin or unforgiveness or selfish desires, it's going to destroy you. It destroys your relationship with God, but it destroys your relationship with others around you as well. It opens you up to Satan's attack. But with repentance, obedience, and faith, you will advance the kingdom of God and live in the victory that is yours through Jesus Christ. Let's just finish with a prayer. Father in heaven, we honor your name. Father, we pray your kingdom would come on earth as it is in heaven. Father, we come before you and we pray you forgive us for our sins. Cleanse us from all unrighteousness, that we may walk in your ways today and tomorrow and the days that are to come. So now I just want to invite you just to confess any sins that need to be confessed before God. Take a moment. The Holy Spirit just brings things to your mind. Tell God about them. Ask for forgiveness. Even in this moment, why not ask the Holy Spirit, is there anything in your house that actually needs to be removed? There's sometimes practical things that need to be done. This act of repentance. Things that maybe you've held on from the past, from the life you lived before you got to know Jesus. Books, artifacts that need to be removed. So we invite you, Holy Spirit, come now. Come and fill us. Just that fresh filling as we prayed last week, we pray again. Come, Holy Spirit. Come and minister into my heart. Come and do deep work of grace. We pray that in the precious, the most glorious name of Jesus, our Saviour. Amen. Guys, if you do want prayer for anything, do get in touch with us. We're going to move on in a moment. Just going to get some notices. They're going to appear on the screen. Then after that, I want you to want to hang around and catch up with one another. It's great just to, in these times of isolation, at least we can gather a little bit at, on Zoom to just have a little chat with one another. So that's going to happen after the notices. We're going to go into our different breakout rooms and get a chance just to catch up and to just spend some time together. God bless you this week. Look after yourselves. We'll see you soon.
I really want to encourage you to keep meeting up with people during the week. One of the best ways we can do this is connecting into one of our house groups, which are meeting as normal via Zoom.
On these unusual days, there we obviously can't get out of the house as much as we'd like to, but there's one thing that we can do, and that is pray. And you can pray in your homes, of course, but also you're able to join us every Sunday evening between 7 to 8 p.m. and we can pray together on Zoom. It's a good opportunity for us to gather, but also to come before the throne of God.
Thankfully, due to technology, all our kids' work has managed to continue. So we have Shine Online for our primary age children. We have Illuminate for our youth. We've even managed to add an extra meeting in. Every weekday morning, our children join together for a daily devotional and Bible study and quiz. We also have a Zoom room for the children on a Sunday morning during the preaching on a separate Zoom number.
Freedom. One of our values is being generous in everything. If you would like to support the work that we're doing, you can give online using these bank details. Thank you so much for all your generosity.